Welcome. Today we would start with political science for class 6th NCERT. We would be talking about first chapter, that is understanding diversity. Now this chapter is a kind of fundamental chapter that lays the foundation stone for other chapters. Here there is much less of political science that we would be understanding, but more of a human behavior or a social behavior that we would try to understand. Now, what is diversity? We can say diversity occurs in terms of religion, in terms of languages, in terms of cultures, in terms of regions. So let's say I have a map of India here. A person in Gujarat might speak Gujarati language. A person in West Bengal region would speak Bengali language. A person in Kerala would speak Malayalam language. So that is a kind of diversity within a nation that we can see. So you have the various languages that is shown here depicting the diversity. Now let's come to religion. We say India is predominantly a Hindu society or a Hindu nation, but still you have other religions like Jainism, Buddhism, Jews, Parsis, Islam that is prevalent across the country. So you have variations in or diversity in religion. Then you have different regions. Now you can mark the regions based on the geographical features, based on the economic conditions, or based on the social conditions. So let's say based on the geographical conditions, I can say these are the coastal regions. Then you have the Deccan Plateau region. You have the desert region. So you have different kind of regions that exist. Now, what is different across the nation or across the various societies that you have? It can be difference in terms of languages, as we said. It can be difference in terms of the clothes a person is wearing, the difference in terms of festivals, difference in terms of the looks or the food that is prevalent in a region. So all these differences are the fundamental cause or the basis for the diversity to occur. So a person living near a coastal area might have a predominant food as fish or rice. A person in the northern plains might have a predominant food, let's say wheat. That would be a kind of staple food that would be there. So there are differences in foods, looks, festivals, clothing and language that is seen across a region or across the area. Now, what is important is to understand the concept of generations. Till of late, it was considered if a father is doing a business of, let's say, pottery, a son would inherit that and would learn only that skill, and that was considered sufficient. But now, with the changing trends, the things are changing. Again, there exists a caste system in the society which has given rise to inequalities. To remove out these inequalities, there were various leaders like B.R. Ambedkar who worked forward, and they tried to bring the society at par. So there were reservations for STSCs, Scheduled Castes, Scheduled Tribes, minorities, which we would see in the further lectures. Now what a person writes. If I am given something to write, what comes to my mind might be different from what another person is writing, and so on and so forth. So let's say if I have a same piece of writing, or I have to write, say, an essay of 2000 words on a topic of my choice, I can write on a topic, let's say, my childhood memories. Some other person can write on the account of kings. One can write on the life of forests, the fights and the friendships, the values and the education, fantasies or fiction. So these are some of the topics that we have picked out. So these show the diversity in writing. And these diversities have led to different thought models that evolved over the time and laid the foundation for the political science in future. Now again, there is a very important concept of assimilation. Assimilation means integrating the various things. So there is a concept, yes or no, whether we are assimilating culturally or not, that has to be given importance and has to be focused on. So let's say generations back, our great grandfathers, I would say, might be using road as a means of transportation, but that road could be a kind of unpaved road with bullock carts or might be, let's say, wheels that were invented. Slowly and gradually, our generation has witnessed buses, aeroplanes, auto rickshaws, and so on and so forth. So there has been changes in the means of transportation. Again, people have been moving constantly. They might move for job, they might move for education, they might move for due to drought, due to famines, due to war, due to earthquake or any natural disaster that has occurred. People also move because of trade. So all these movements have led to kind of intermingling of the people. So let's say a people from Rajasthan is moving to West Bengal. So he is taking along the culture from Rajasthan to West Bengal. So that has led to a kind of cultural assimilation among different areas. Now a city and a countryside, let's say. So you have a city and a rural area or the vicinity, which we also call it as a countryside. The city depends on the market for vegetables and fruits. On the other hand, you have countryside where you have the farm production that takes place within the village itself. Now, in this chapter, there has been a coverage for two extreme regions of India itself. One is Ladakh region and another is Kerala. So you have Kerala here, and then towards the Jammu Kashmir region of India, you have the Leh Ladakh that is seen. So what are the differences in the lifestyle of a people living of a person living in Ladakh and a person living in Kerala would be understood in this section. Now Ladakh is a region of cold desert. Sheep are commonly seen there. So you have Pashmina wool that is prevalent. You have many people who are engaged in that act of wool making, and woolen carpets are seen. Again, meat and milk are the predominant production. The animals that are seen are goats, cows and dozos, that are the yak cows they are known as. Now this Ladakh region was the route or the trade route from China or the Tibet area. What was brought through this trade route was mainly textile, spices and silk. Now this region has influence of both Buddhism and Islam, and you have a kind of impact of China on the region. Again, this region is traditionally rich in the various songs and poetries. Now let's come to the Kerala region. Kerala region has been highly influenced by Arab travelers. So Arab travelers came to Kerala coast, in contrast to Chinese travelers who came to Ladakh region first. So Jews and Arabs were the first to come here. Again, you have Vasco da Gama from Portugal who came here. Ibn Battuta has written a lot on the life of Muslims in this region. The vegetation that is seen here is mainly pepper, cardamom and cloves. This region is surrounded by sea, so it has kind of backwaters and coastal area that is seen. Again, you have fishing nets that are used here, which have a word similar to a Chinese word, that is chinawala, and the utensils they use to fry is known as china chatti. Again, rice and wheat are the predominant food habits that could be seen here. Now, the most important concept for this lecture is the concept of unity in diversity. Despite so much differences that we have seen in terms of religion, language, region, culture, and so on, there is a kind of unity across the nation. Now that unity has been witnessed in the form of the various episodes of the independence movement that we would see further in this section on history. Now, Britishers have tried to work around the divide and rule policy in India that ultimately failed, and we were united against a common fight for the Britishers. So you had the Jallianwala Bagh massacre that happened, where General Dyer opened the firing and the people laid down their lives in the well at the Jallianwala Bagh itself. It was a kind of complete unity, where there was no Muslim, no Hindu, no rich and no poor, and all of the people laid down their life for India. So you have songs, symbols and anthem which bound the nation, or which bring the nation much closer. The word or the phrase unity in diversity was first given by Pandit Nehru. And when he was trying to explain his feelings in the book Discovery of India, he explained Unity is something that does not come from outside. It is something that is witnessed by us from within. So we have a kind of passion and tolerance for something, and that ultimately leads us for this close binding, which we call as unity in diversity. So that was the essence for the first chapter. We'll be continuing further chapters in political science in the upcoming lectures. You can subscribe to our channel for further updates. Have a good day ahead.